Well, I guess I had multiple highlights. One was when I came to CECOM, I was living 5 miles from where I had been born and raised, which was pretty terrific. And then once I got there, another highlight was obviously working with some of the greatest people I've ever worked with for a number of years that I had several different assignments. One thing I noticed about those folks, they were all dedicated to supporting the warfighter, and it was just terrific to learn from them and be with them and to help lead them in doing what we needed to do to support the troops in the field. All of that said, I would say one of the best and most important things that was a highlight for me was what I call digitizing the battlefield, where we took unlike technologies and tried to make sure that the entire battlefield had a common picture with a network that was robust enough to support it. When I say common picture, I mean so that an aviator could see it, a soldier could see it, and anybody in a tank could see it, or any other vehicle. That was an exceptional highlight for us. When I was a lieutenant is where I first had my interface with CECOM. I learned how to climb poles and gaff into the pole so that I could be a pole line platoon leader, construction platoon leader over in Korea. After that, I came back to the R&D center and the base ops, where I was the head of the procurement operation that supported those two outfits. And it was a utilization of my second specialty, which was acquisition. Third job was actually a PM, and after that I became the PEO of 8 different PMs, where we fielded multi-million dollar and billion dollar systems like MSC, Singar's radio, satellite equipment, both tactical and strategic, as well as global positioning system. Then finally, I was given the opportunity, with a lot of good training in all those jobs, to be the commanding general of Fort Monmouth, where I not only commanded the logistics center, the acquisition center, and the R&D center, but also I had the opportunity to command the post at Fort Monmouth and the post at Vin Hill Farms. That I had the opportunity, being close to where I lived, and my youngest daughter going to school 4 years. When she graduated, she was a salutatorian of Monmouth High School. And I was invited to be the guest speaker, and she got on the platform and gave a salutatorian speech. So I can tell you she gave a lot better speech than I did, but I was really honored to do that. And then the last thing I'd say that was kind of a fond memory was I got all my best information by going out on the golf course, the bowling alley, or in a little restaurant that I called the Rise and Shine, where people would come in and talk to me. And my staff never knew where I got all this information, but it sure helped me to do a better job as a commander. Well, it was two challenges, really, and both evolved around BRAC. When I first got there as a local boy coming in to command CECOM, we got word that they were going to shut half of CECOM down and move half of it to Rock Island Arsenal. So that was the first challenge, and we got by that okay. They reversed their decision. We didn't move to Rock Island. And then the second really tough challenge for me was that the announcement a couple of years later, towards the end of my command, that Vin Hill Farms was closing. And I felt a real personal concern for the people, so I made a lot of trips down to make sure the people were taken care of, and I understood why they were closed, with the ability to do most of that on other bases that was down there. They didn't need the antenna field anymore, nor did they really need to have the National Inventory Control Point there for aviation. So we moved that to Toby Hanna, and we closed the base down, and we pretty much took care of most of the people with jobs in other locations. So, but it was a big challenge. You know, what I would say to you is that in retrospect, I didn't realize how important digitizing the battlefield was. And I realized that as I left the command and I understood the vision of the chief of staff even better, about what a big force multiplier that could be for the troops in the field. And I probably, in retrospect, would have pushed it even harder than I did when I was here. But then when I left here and went to my job in the Pentagon for my last job in the Army, I did push it, and we pushed it as hard as we possibly could because we knew it could be a dynamite capability for our warfighters. And we knew that it, once they had it in their hands, once we made it robust enough to work right, that it would be a tremendous asset to them in warfighting. Throughout my life, I've learned to be a good listener, and now I know that's probably the most important form of communications you can have. And I think by being a good listener, you also, as a leader, will act with a servant heart to serve the people that work with you and around you. And if you follow those two guidelines, you're always going to be successful as a person, and you're going to be respected. And I think that, you know, trying to do that and act as a servant leader with people will serve whatever organization you're with well, and it'll serve the people well because they will perform magnificently for you.